Hi everybody, this is Ron LeGrand, and I'm going to go through my property information sheet here. And I'm doing this for all real estate investors to make sure that we're clear on how to get this form filled out, because this is the heartbeat of our business right here. This is the form that comes into us usually through our virtual assistants, and it helps us determine whether we have a suspect or a prospect or any reason to call back the seller in these cases. Without this form, we have no leads. With this form completely filled out, then we have the proper leads to move us forward to get them turned into deals. With this form improperly filled out, we have really nothing but an improperly filled out form. So if you are the real estate investor or the person assigned to make these calls, let me go through this step by step to make sure you know exactly what we need and why we need it. This is the sheet where we collect all the information. Usually our virtual assistants make these calls to ads that are on the internet, on Craigslist, on all the local for sale by owner sites, as well as in the print magazines like your local newspaper, your regional papers, and wherever you can get people that are advertising that their house is for sale. In addition to that, a lot of times people will ride around and look at the signs in the front yard, the for sale by owner signs, and they'll just snap a picture of it with their camera and go home and make the call because the phone number is right on the sign, and then fill out the form. The form is designed to either make an outbound call to a person who advertises they have a house for sale, or to take the incoming call and collect the same information. Let's start here at the top. I've designed this so the student puts their name on it. Sometimes we have a class and we have the students bring these to class, and that's for them, so that we recognize who the deal belongs to, because we process a lot of them in class. I want the owner's name up here and the owner's cell phone and the evening phone, because yes, people still do have home phones, and if we can't reach them on one, we want to get them on the other. It's always good that we capture the source of where the call came from, so we'll know what advertising is working, so that if you're making an outbound call, put the publication, put Craigslist, put the newspaper or whatever right there. Of course, the date. And then obviously we have to have the address in the city, and I like the area of town that the property is located in. I know that in Jacksonville, Florida, where I live, if you tell me the area of town, south side, north side, east side, west side, or whatever, then I'll instantly know approximately where the house is, and that'll tell me whether I'm real interested or just totally not interested sometimes. Over here, now here's where you see the stars. Wherever you see a star, it is critical that we get the information. If you see a star and we do not get that blank filled in, then this sheet is worthless. Without these stars filled in, we got no place to go, except somebody's got to get on the telephone, call the seller back, and get the information filled in, because we can't process the lead. We're starting right here with asking price. You must ask the seller, what are you asking for the house? And if you get a flack on that, you got to keep asking them. What are you asking for the house? Sometimes the seller will say, I don't know, come on out and make me an offer. I can't come out and make you an offer. My boss can't come make you an offer till we know what you're asking. What are you asking for the house? And you have to keep pushing on that until you get an answer. And then if you just can't get an answer, well, okay, how about a dollar? And of course they'll say, no, I gotta have at least blank. And now you got your answer. But this thing is not going to be of any value to the person that asks you to make these calls unless you find out what the asking price is. Normally you have no problem with that at all. Now I want to know the seller's estimated value. In other words, what do you think the house would appraise for if we had it appraised? Let them tell you what they think it's worth, and that blank must be filled in. Now the next one down here is not necessarily for the virtual assistant to ask, but either the virtual assistant or the real estate investor has to go do a little bit of work and find some comps or some comparable sales on the property, so that we'll know whether the seller is asking too much or too little based on what we think the property's worth. So you real estate investors, that might be up to you, or you can train your virtual assistants on what sites to go on to and spend a little time with them to let them bring you the top two or three comps that they can find. Sites like Zillow.com, for example. So again, this line you need, but it may not be done by your VA. That's entirely up to the investors. So, got to have the asking price and got to have the seller's estimated value. Now, you'll notice this oblong block here. This is pretty important stuff because we can't go anywhere if that blank is not filled in. Now, this is the information about the loan. Notice the star. I must have the loan amount. Cannot do anything without the loan amount. This is a totally worthless piece of information without that filled in. I don't much care about the lender, but if they know it, get it. I don't much care about the rate, but if they know it, get it. But I am very important, very critical about the payment. So the two most important numbers on here are the loan amount and the payment. I can't do anything without them. So you have to keep pressing until you get that answer. Now sometimes they'll say, well, we don't think that's any of your business. Well, there's a script that your real estate investor can provide to you that'll overcome that objection. And wouldn't do any good for me to repeat it here now, but it's in the system that, where this property information sheet came from. And it goes something like, well, listen, sometimes I pay cash, and sometimes we take over debt, sometimes we lease purchase, but to do any of the above, I must know what's owed on the house to determine whether I can, what I would be interested in purchasing it or not. So that's the long and the short of it. What do you owe? And if you cannot get an answer to that question after you ask a couple of times, then you just write on here, seller refuses after three attempts. Your investor must know that you tried hard to get that answer. And if you do try hard and you do put that down, then they'll know it's probably a waste of the time for them to follow up. But I'm telling you, they're not going to trust your answer unless you can convince them that you tried hard and the seller just totally flat refused. A seller that will not give us the loan amount is a seller we're not buying a house from. Totally unmotivated seller. Now also down here, you notice is the payment PITI, that stands for principal, interest, taxes, and insurance. Most of them are. When you get the payment, you just say, is that PITI? Most sellers know what that means. If it is, just check yes or no. Now, if it is, then you must ask, is it current or in arrears? Of course, if it's current, you check yes. But if it's in arrears, we need an approximate amount that it's behind. Can you have any idea about how much you're behind or how many months you're behind? Give us something to work with there because it's important we have that filled in if it is in arrears. And in fact, it's so important that it'll make or break the deal for the investor. If it's too far behind, it might take us totally out of the picture. So we need to know that. All right, now, let's get down here to the most important script on the whole thing, right here. These center sections right here are the determining factor as to whether the investor is going to do anything with this prospect or not. So let's take a look at it. It says right here, is the house free and clear? That means if the seller has told you up here that there's no mortgage on the house, then and only then do you ask this question. And the question is, will you consider asking monthly payments for your equity? If, regardless of whether their answer is yes or no, it must be circled here. See, it says circle one. It doesn't say circle one if you feel like it. It doesn't say circle one if the mood strikes you. It says circle one. If the house is free and clear, this lead is worthless unless you circle yes or no right there. Please do not circle it just to be circling it. Your investor wants to know if the seller has interest in taking monthly payments or not, and it's a very important piece of information for them. So if it says no, you will notice that it asks you to go right here where it says, if no. If they say yes, you go down here to the yes column and say, okay, I'll have my boss call you back and find out what time would be good to call. And you're done. And you're done. Okay? So up here, if it says no, if this one is no, then it guides you to go right there. If no, would you consider a lease purchase making us responsible for all of the repairs? Okay? If they say no, then you circle no and you drop down to here. So you're saying if you don't get full price and all cash, you won't sell. Now, and so we want a yes or no there. If it is a yes, we know that this is a waste of the investor's time and they won't even bother with them. So to recapture here, if I get a yes, they would consider owner financing. That's a hot deal. If I get a yes, they would consider a lease purchase. That's a hot deal. If I get a no, I want to know that you've asked this question. So you're saying if you don't get full price and all cash, you won't sell? And if that's a yes, then we know this is totally, totally out of the picture. So, and down here you can see that it says also, okay, I understand that, but wouldn't make sense for us. That's assuming that they say yes to this right here. So you're saying if you don't get full price and all cash, you won't sell? Yes. Okay, I understand, but that wouldn't make sense for us. Thanks, and you're done. If they say no here now, okay, well, I'll have my boss call to discuss several ways we can buy your house. So this script, just study it a little bit, and you'll see that it flows very nicely if you look at it and practice a little bit. Again, what we're looking for is a yes or a no here, and of course your investor is going to like the yeses or yes and no on the lease option question. Now, let's go back here for a minute. Up here, if there's a mortgage amount, which there usually is, in fact, about 30% of the houses out there today are free and clear, the rest of them have a mortgage on them. So if it's got a mortgage here, this says if there's a mortgage on the house, you start here. If there's a mortgage here, you totally ignore this block and you go right to here. If we can agree upon a price and accept the responsibility for the future for the repairs, would you consider a lease purchase? Again, yes or no. Your investor's looking to have that circle. Must have one of those circle. If it's yes, okay, I'll have my boss call you, get a time. If it's no, so you're saying if you don't get full price, sound familiar. Okay, must have a yes or no. If this is no, then we want this one circled as well. Okay, so it goes right on down, you follow the script, and all we want you to do is make sure that the person assigning you to make these calls gets either a yes or a no, if here, same thing. Now over here, if the asking price and the loan balance are within $35,000, so if you go back up here a little bit, you'll see up here, we ask for the asking price. Okay, so if that asking price, let's say that's $200,000, and the loan balance down here is $175,000, then that will trigger you to go here. Will you sell the house for what you owe on it, yes or no? And that must be checked. Now, you only ask this question if you've got a small gap between the loan and the asking price. Do not ask this question if there's a lot of equity in it. Take that same $200,000 house, if they owe $110,000 on it, and they're asking $180,000, it would be foolish to ask them if they would take what they owe. In fact, it would probably embarrass you and them and tick them off, and immediately they would think, well, I'm dealing with an idiot here. I don't want to talk to him anymore. So common sense here. Only when there's a small gap between the loan and the asking do you ask this question, just like it says right there. If there's a loan and there's some equity in it, or even if it's over finance, you're going to get a lot of them where the loan balance is higher than what they think the house is worth. If that's true, then make sure you ask the lease option question. Obviously, the free and clear one wouldn't apply because it's over financed, and this one wouldn't apply because there's no equity in it. But this one definitely applies. Today, we have a system to where our investors can make money with over leveraged houses. So it's very important that we get an answer to yes or no if the house is over leveraged, which is quite a bit of the ones you're going to be talking to. By the way, they're the most flexible and easiest to get along with too. All right, let's move on down here and make sure we get the rest of this done, okay? How did you arrive at the asking price? You know, I would like to have that and a reason for selling, but you'll notice it's not near as critical as the rest of the questions because it doesn't have a star. Now, does the house need repairs? I definitely need the answer to that. In fact, that should have a star right there. It should have a star. So does it need repairs, yes or no? Now, if they say yes, your question would be, well, can you give me a general idea how much do you think they would cost? Are they very small repairs? Are they minimal? Does the house need a major rehab? Give me an idea what it needs. And you kind of make a note down here so your investor has a clue. So if it says yes, you ought to have some kind of a footnote down here describing what they're talking about. Now, when you want to move, notice it's got a star, because we just want to find out if they're ready to go or if they're just playing and looking for somebody to come out and look at their house, and we're not interested in that. They're only interested in people who want to sell, so that's why that question is there. And is the house listed is also very important. You must put in there yes or no, because if it's listed, it's a totally different thing than if it's not listed. All right, down here, bedrooms and bath, 3/2, 5/3, whatever it is, square footage, 2,000, 2,500, or whatever. Lot size, I'm not so much concerned about, but all the rest of these things, is it a frame, brick, block, stucco? Just check one. Does it have a carport, or a carpet, or a garage, one or two car garage, or carport, basement, and so forth. Now, down here is very important. Please get this one checked. Is the house vacant, or is it occupied? And if it's a condo, is it a condo, and if it is, then we're going to want to know the association fees. Again, if you check yes, it's a condo, then I want to know what the monthly association fees are. And of course, vacant or occupied is also important to our investors, because they know whether they're going to have free access to the house, whether the seller's motivated, and obviously they're more motivated if they're already out of the house. So, I think that's it in a nutshell. It's not a complicated form. It will take a few phone calls for you to get used to it. Study it a little bit. The script down here, really not difficult, but practice. Remember, your investor wants the form completely filled out, the best you can do. But I will tell you, if you get a no, they will not owner finance, and a no, that they will not do a lease purchase, then I wouldn't spend a whole lot of time collecting this information down here. I still would want the bedrooms and the baths and the square footage, and maybe check whether it's a brick or block, but don't waste any time down here, because if you get a no-no at the top, it's very likely that your investor is not going to be able to do anything with this project at all. So, I hope that kind of clarifies how important this thing is. Again, this is the heartbeat of the business. Without it, there's nowhere to go from there, so it's up to you to get it completely filled out, and then if you have any issues with that, then talk to the person who assigned you to the task and work them out and go back and forth until you get it. And you are going to have trouble reaching some people, of course. You're going to have to make 2 or 3 calls. So what I would suggest you do is that you call in the evening between 6 and 9. It's usually the best time to get people home. And if you don't get them, then I'd try in the a.m. Of course, some people are home in the morning. They're not at night. And then I try in the middle of the day. So you should make at least 3 attempts to reach the person on the telephone, each time leaving them a message. Now, if I'm instructing you what to do the third time, the message would start to get a little brutal. This is the third and the last time that I've called to inquire about the house that you advertised that you wanted to sell. So if you still have interest, please call me back immediately. I won't be calling you again. That sometimes prompts a call when they see that you're done chasing them. So I hope that answers any questions you have, and thank you very much for watching.